Hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to RBI 247. So as you all must be knowing that in this series called RBI 247, we try to discuss some concepts related to economics and finance, basically current affairs, that can be helpful to you if you are preparing for any competitive exam, right? So we are going to discuss 5 questions, and before moving to question number 1, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel anujindal.in. Subscribing to us can provide you with access to a lot of good content, and don't forget to press this bell icon which is flashing on the screen. It can help you to stay in touch with us, and don't forget to join our Telegram group. On this group you can post all your doubts and queries, and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. So are you guys ready for question number 1? And here is your question number 1, which says, a dash is an individual or a company who has enough money and power to directly influence the price of a cryptocurrency stock, usually in a negative way. So here we are talking about different type of traders in stock market, right, who trade in different type of commodities. So it can be cryptocurrency, it can be a stock, or it can be any other commodity. So you have to tell the correct answer out of these five options. And the correct option for this question is option C, that is whale. So a whale trader or a whale investor is a powerful investor. So I think we all have heard about bulls and bears till now, but whale is also a term here. And whale, what does whale signify? Whale is such a big creature, it signifies power, right? It signifies influence. So that is why, just as a whale has power due to its big size, similarly an investor or an individual who has a lot of money to buy or sell shares in one transaction, so that it can drive the price of commodities up and down, that investor is known as a whale investor. I think we have talked about this, that how in common talk you can hear people saying badi machli, or they referring to a big investor as a badi machli, and little and small traders who follow this badi machli to their actions, right? So that is why a whale investor. So whale investing is quite popular in the field of cryptocurrency, especially Bitcoin. So you must have heard about Bitcoin whales who have such a good stock of Bitcoins that if they sell, they can push the prices down, or they have so much money that if they buy, they can push the prices up, right? Here you can see whales. Bitcoin whales move around the cryptocurrency space, causing waves at every turn. Just as a whale jumps and causes waves in sea or in the water because of their movement, similarly there are these whales in the stock market or in the commodity market who can cause a change of direction of market at every movement, at every turn, right? So they can be a cause of concern because they have the power to drive prices, right? So do you understand? Here we are talking about that whatever the fundamentals of the commodity or the asset whose prices are being affected, this whale can drive the prices irrespective of those fundamentals. So if a really big investor sells the share of a very good company, a company with good finances, that can drive its prices down without any of its fault, right? So that is why whales are a cause of concern, especially in case of cryptocurrency, where they are very popular. Because see, there are not much buyers in crypto parlance, right? As of now, there are not many investors, since it is a new mode of investment. That is why not much number of investors. So the little investors who have the power, they have the power to drive market, right? Small number of people having control or power, right? After that, bulls and bears. I think we all must be familiar with these terms, but still we'll discuss them in brief. Bull is an individual or an investor or an institution who has a positive outlook of market, and they keep on buying and buying securities in the hope that in future the prices will rise and then they are going to sell the securities, right? So when the market trend is up, we are witnessing a bull run. When the prices are rising, there are higher highs and higher lows, right? Characterized with optimism and investor confidence. After that, bear, exact opposite of bull, having a negative outlook towards market, and characterized by downward movements. And yes, bears are also very important for the market, because it is because of them that correction takes place in the market. Correction is a very common term. You can read it in newspapers on a daily basis, especially in a very uncertain times, correction word is used. So what is correction? All those companies or all those securities whose prices are inflated or overvalued, these people or these investors known as bears who have a negative outlook, they sell the shares or they drive their prices down to the fundamentals. So bulls and bears, they both are important for the market, having their own significance. Moving ahead to question number 2. So here is your question number 2, which says it involves introducing relatively small amounts of government funds into a depressed economy in order to spur growth. What does it refer to? So as you can see, the statement talks about some sort of liquidity infusion into market. You have to tell that what is the correct option out of these 5, right? Moving ahead to the correct option, and the correct option for this question is option A, that is pump priming. It means infusing money into economy in smaller amounts but in a continuous trend, right? As you can see here, action taken to stimulate an economy, just as a pipe or a pump is used for the movement of water. Pump priming means pumping liquidity into the economy or pumping money into the economy to give it a kickstart, usually during a recessionary period through government spending, interest rate and tax reductions. So derived from the operation of older pumps, a suction valve had to be primed with water so that pump would function properly. So this is what it is named after. After that, pump priming, it relates to Keynesian economic theory named after John Keynes, which states that government intervention within the economy aimed at increasing aggregate demand. So here is the key term, aimed at increasing aggregate demand, because demand generation is one thing that can lead an economy out of a recessionary phase. As you can see in current times also, we are experiencing a suppressed demand due to the outbreak of coronavirus. So governments are trying to put money into hands of people, as you must have seen statements by many economists who are advising governments to put money into the hands of people through different measures so that they can spend on some items and then they can drive the economy, right? So generation of aggregate demand is the major aim of pump priming. Can result in a positive shift within the economy. This is the Keynesian economic theory. So this is based on cyclical nature of money, that one person's spending is another person's income, right? So this is the basic principle behind this theory, that if you are buying a chocolate from your nearby store, then you are spending the money, but that shopkeeper is earning in that transaction, and then that shopkeeper is going to spend those 100 rupees you just spent on chocolate on some other thing, probably depositing his children's school fee, right? So that is a spending for him but an income for the school. So this is a chain that continues, and as money change hands, it creates value. So this growth of economy is based on this principle, right? Moving ahead to question number 3 for today, and here is your question number 3, which talks about Pigou effect. So you have to select the correct statement about Pigou effect. So this topic was mentioned by Ishita in the comments. I hope Ishita, you watch this session and you learn about this effect. So moving ahead to correct option for this question, and the correct option is D. Pigou effect states that situations of recessions and inflation are self-correcting mechanism and can restore the balance on their own. So this effect says that the cycles of the economy, they are self-correcting, that one phase comes and after that, after then it fades away, then another phase comes. As you can see here, let's say if there is a recessionary period in an economy and unemployment is rising, as you can see here in this picture, unemployment is rising, that indicates a recessionary phase. Now what will happen because of this fallen unemployment, because of this rising unemployment, when there are lesser jobs, unemployment is there, prices are going to fall because of the fallen demand. So these people who do not have any jobs, they are not going to make any demand. That is why the prices of commodities, they fall. As you can see in the picture, prices fall. When the prices fall, the net worth of people increases. And how does this net worth works? You can see here. Defining wealth as money supply divided by current price levels. So this theory, this effect divides money supply by current price levels to find wealth. Let us just write this formula. So wealth is equals to money supply divided by price levels. Right. Now what is happening due to unemployment, due to rampant unemployment in the economy, prices are going to fall because of fallen demand. When prices fall, this wealth increases, right? Because if the denominator is falling, the value of the ratio is going to increase. That is why people can buy more of the commodity if the prices fall. Coming back to the diagram, so people can buy more. This increase in buying activity generates demand and generates consumption. Now, since people who have money, they can buy more, they are going to demand more, and to fulfill this demand, companies would have to function more, they will have to expand, and for that expansion they will have to find or hire new employees. When they hire new employees, they create employment in the economy. Right. So do you see how this mechanism is self-correcting? So we can start with employment or too much employment. We can start with the inflationary phase and we can see how it balances itself in a reverse order. Right. So this is the Pigou effect. Alternatively, inflation of prices, employment and output will be decreased due to decrease in consumption. So this Pigou effect is known as real balance effect because it creates balance in the economy, right? I hope now you are clear with this question and we can move ahead to the next question for today. So here is your fourth question, which says, what percentage of provisions has to be created by banks on bad loans? A very simple question. Let's see what the correct answer is. The correct answer is C, that is 15%. So 15% means banks have to create a provision of this percentage. So we are talking about this in context of a recent news that RBI, so the moratorium that the central bank had provided to retail and corporate borrowers that they can defer their payments, that just ended on 31st August. But after that, there were speculations that what is going to happen, whether all the borrowers would have to make payment to their lenders, or is the central bank going to increase this moratorium further. So Supreme Court said, as you can see here, handed an interim extension of loan moratorium. So an extension on this moratorium was provided to the borrowers. So till now it has been decided that all the borrowers who were considered as standard, they are not going to be considered as bad assets even if there is a default till any further orders, right? So the government is going to tell that whether lenders have to classify them as defaulters or not, because see, anyone who was a standard before starting of this moratorium, that proves that they are into this financial difficulty because of COVID-19, right? So basically, government wants to help those borrowers who are in difficulty because of COVID, and that is why they are saying that it's okay, do not classify them as bad assets. So bankers are hopeful that they also won't have to set aside funds to cover losses once a loan turns bad because of the temporary freeze in asset classification. So here is a temporary freeze, and bankers are hoping that they might not have to make any additional provisions for that. You can see here, banks have to make a provision of 15% when loans turn bad, whereas for standard loans, they have to make a provision of 0.4 to 1%. So you can see how it is very convenient for them, because if they classify assets as bad, their provision requirements are going to rise. So repayments were expected to begin on 1st September after 6-month moratorium ended a day earlier. So the moratorium ended on 31st August. So the bankers were expecting the money to come back as the moratorium ended, but let's see what happens. We'll have to wait and watch to see what is going to happen further. Okay, here is your fifth question for today. This is the last question, which says a dash audit is an examination and evaluation of a firm's or an individual's financial record to derive evidence that can be used in a court of law or legal proceeding. So you have to tell the correct answer that what type of audit is conducted to be helpful in cases in court proceedings. Let's see what the correct answer is. And the correct option for this question is option A, that is forensic audit. So just as there are forensic teams to help police investigate any case, to analyze the evidences that the police find out, and to derive implication, to derive conclusions out of them which can be used in a court of law. Similarly, a forensic audit is conducted to find out minor details or minute details from the finances which can be used against a person in a court of law or a company in a court of law. As you can see here, that can be used in a court of law or legal proceeding. Specialization within the field of accounting. So a person who is conducting this forensic audit has to be specialized in this field of accounting. Then only he or she would be able to find out these minute details. And most large accounting firms have a forensic accounting department, for forensic auditing department. So forensic audit require the expertise of accounting and auditing procedures, as well as expert knowledge about the legal framework of such an audit. So apart from a good knowledge of accounting and auditing, the person should also have good legal knowledge and may be conducted to prosecute a party for fraud, embezzlement or any financial crime. So as I told you, so any person who is being investigated, who has to be presented, or any cases going against any entity, against that entity a forensic audit can be conducted, or it can be helpful to find out financial evidences. So they can also be used, these type of audits can also be used in situations which do not involve financial fraud, such as disputes related to bankruptcy filings, business closures and divorces, right? So in these cases, forensic audits can be used. So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. And if you did, then don't forget to give us a thumbs up. I'll be back tomorrow with some new set of information that might be helpful for you, right? So I'll see you tomorrow. Till then, take care of your health and keep your studies going on. This is Mansi Anand signing off. See you tomorrow, and thank you for being here.